legalized and licensed. KPBS News goes inside San Diego's first pot shop as it gets ready to open on New Year's Day.
There are times where I have all this makeup on, but like a beard. And there are other times when I am in a dress and no makeup.
Embracing the freedom to choose, the new state law that lets people choose a third gender on state documents.
Because I like aggro and also just get stuff out there. Beat down. Yeah.
She's got game, the pint-sized player who's taking a fantasy card game by storm. KPBS Evening Edition starts right now. Good evening, and thanks for joining us. I'm Ebony Monet. San Diego marijuana dispensaries are preparing for a wave of new business on Monday when recreational sales become legal. KPBS Metro reporter Andrew Bowen says some are even throwing a party.
Okay, so here at Torrey Holistics, we sell all different cannabis products. We have tinctures, topicals, edibles.
Christine Bordenave is general manager of Torrey Holistics in Sorrento Valley.
Sure, how many would you like?
It's one of the handful of stores in San Diego with a license to sell recreational cannabis on New Year's Day.
We are expecting a huge crowd. We're going to be having food trucks here, as well as live music and some of our vendors to educate our patients about the different products that we have.
For years, medical marijuana has been pretty easy for Californians to access. But Bordenave says she's still expecting recreational or adult use sales to give a boost to business.
A lot of people have been, you know, nervous to be part of the medical cannabis community. With adult use sales, they'll be able to come in freely and purchase cannabis and try new products. So I really think there's going to be a huge surge of new patients.
CannaPro? That's just a different manufacturer. So.
Customers will have to wait until they get home to smoke or eat anything they buy. Public cannabis consumption is still illegal.
Have a great day. Thank you.
Andrew Bowen, KPBS News.
The marijuana business is more than just the point of sale. Behind the scenes, growers and distributors are part of the process. And already, small businesses are facing competition from large corporations. AP reporter Krista Fourier has the story.
As California gears up to legalize recreational marijuana in January, more companies are taking on each step of production, from cultivation to creating a product. A process known as vertical integration.
Initially, all we wanted to do was make canna strips. Unfortunately, we couldn't find a consistency of product.
So Lifestyle Delivery Systems decided to grow their own cannabis. They built an $8 million state-of-the-art marijuana factory in Southern California. The company plans to produce 50,000 canna strips an hour. Oral strips billed as the fastest way to get cannabis in the bloodstream.
If we're going to do that kind of volume and control the ingredients that goes into it, it's not going to be a cottage industry. We're not doing it at a craft beer level. We're doing it in a mass-produced way.
But it's this kind of mass production that worries many smaller operations. They fear investment banks and corporate-sized interests will push them out of the market.
I think the only way the small operators are really going to have a chance is if we really do kind of band together and we kind of support and we continue with kind of the ecosystem we've created.
Eric Holstrom is a Los Angeles cultivator who has been working in the marijuana industry for 12 years. He says the only thing he can do is rely on the quality of his product.
One thing I'm comfortable with and confident about is that I know my market, I've been in my market, and I'm confident in my ability to produce really nice cannabis.
As legalization in California ushers in new opportunities, big and small companies are fighting for a piece of what will be the largest legal pot economy in the country. Krista Fourier, Associated Press, Los Angeles.
KPBS News will be covering the start of marijuana sales in the days ahead, including the opening of local shops on New Year's Day. For more of our stories, go to kpbs.org. Whether it's marijuana, alcohol, or any other substance, CHP will be watching for impaired drivers this holiday weekend. A maximum enforcement period began this afternoon and will last through Monday evening. Nearly 30 people died on highways in California last New Year's weekend. More than 750 people were arrested for DUI. San Diego State University hit a new milestone for its stadium plan in Mission Valley. Supporters say they've collected 100,000 signatures for a measure that would let the school take over SDCCU Stadium. That's more than enough to qualify for next year's ballot. The school wants to build a 35,000-seat stadium, plus develop sites for new classrooms, housing, and retail. Council members are expected to let voters choose between San Diego State or a competing Soccer City plan. A busy day at county offices where people are rushing to make early payments on their property taxes.
Now serving 9, 5, 8 at counter 7.
This is what it looked like at the office in Kearny Mesa. The San Diego Union-Tribune reports the county expects to receive nearly 40,000 additional early payments compared to last year. That totals an estimated $140 million. It's all due to the tax bill passed by Congress, which caps deductions on federal returns to $10,000.
Right now, there's no limit to itemized deductions. But starting next year, itemized deductions of state and local income tax will be limited to $10,000. And in our case, our state and local income tax will exceed that, so it's more beneficial to pay it now, where I can take it as an unlimited deduction, than wait next year when it will be limited.
I may have not bought my new home. I could have stayed where I had been living if the new law was in effect right now, yes. It's going to affect certain home ownership in high-end neighborhoods. Yes, it will.
Those who want to make early payments can still do so online by midnight on Sunday or postmark by December 31st if sending by mail. President Donald Trump says there will not be a deal to protect so-called dreamers unless he gets funding for a border wall. The comments came in a tweet this morning. The president says he also wants other changes to immigration policy. DACA is deferred action for childhood arrivals and offers protections to undocumented immigrants brought to the U.S. as children. The Obama-era policy will end in March unless a deal is reached. Democrats say they will insist on a fix as part of negotiations to avoid a government shutdown next month. The Gender Recognition Act is a new law in California, authored by San Diego Senator Tony Atkins, who will soon be the first woman to serve as state Senate president. It will allow people to choose a third gender option, non-binary, on driver's licenses and other state documents. It's an effort to acknowledge that some Californians don't identify as either male or female. Tonight, we'll bring you the story of one such person.
Hey, how are you, my dear?
I'm David Vance. I'm non-binary, and we are here at Baby Cakes because it was a key pivotal place for me coming into my identity. When I first started wearing makeup and rejecting gender more explicitly and visibly, this was always where I would go because I knew I would be safe and welcome, and people complimented my makeup, so that helps too. The first word we have to talk about is the word binary. So specifically in the context of gender, that's referring to the social cultural mandate that we have created in our society, because it is very much a creation of our society, that there are only two ways you can exist as a human being, man, woman, and that's it. And that's the script that we're, you know, imbibed with from birth. So being non-binary is basically not identifying with man or woman. It's been kind of a process, but I've reached a point now where I'm just really kind of, yeah, still all over the place. There are times where I have all this makeup on, but like a beard. And there are other times when I am in a dress and no makeup. And there are other times when I'm, you know, totally butched out and have facial hair and my tank top and my, you know, all my other shit. So it really just depends on the day. I grew up in a very, you know, hyper-conservative, rural, very closed-off, sheltered part of Wisconsin. For my family, they were incredibly uncomfortable with the makeup for a long time. And I would post pictures, and my mom would literally text me and tell me to take them down. And I remember when I first came out, literally the one thing one of my family members told me was, just don't wear makeup and do your nails. Just still act like a man. So it took them a while. So I am the PrEP coordinator here at the center. PrEP is a once-a-day pill that prevents HIV infection. Specifically, the work that we're trying to do right now is center the trans community in our HIV testing and PrEP outreach and education. So that's been really cool for me, just because I've sort of, again, I consider myself under the trans umbrella for sure. So I've sort of gotten to grow into myself a little bit, but also it really helps me connect with my clients. Hi, my dear, this is David, the PrEP coordinator over at the center. Just giving you a quick call to check in. The conversations that I can have with another non-binary person or with a trans person are just on a different level in so many ways, because there's such a high level of empathy and understanding and trust. And trust is absolutely huge in relationships with clients.
We are here to announce that we've introduced Senate Bill 179, the Gender Recognition Act of 2017.
So if the Gender Recognition Act were to pass, that would be a level of legitimacy and recognition on an institutional level, first and foremost. And I know that kind of sounds like abstract and weird, but I think for me personally, yes, absolutely. Like, I would love to be able to have NB or non-binary on my driver's license, on my birth certificate, possibly. But I think what it would mean most to me is it's really bringing us out into the open. It is making us visible on a level that other people who maybe would not view non-binary as something legitimate before would now go, huh, oh, wait a minute, maybe this is an actual thing. So I think that's really what the biggest gain would be. It would be a really huge, hugely powerful institutional level statement of non-binary people exist and are real, and not everybody fits into one of two boxes.
That story was produced by reporter Andrew Bowen and video journalist Katie Shulove. Since it first aired this summer, Governor Jerry Brown has signed the Gender Recognition Act. The law takes effect in 2019. A little colder tonight, but not that much change in the weather forecast. The warm, dry trend continues. Julia Wyden has more in tonight's forecast.
Here's a look at what's going on as we head into the weekend. After a pretty warm finish to the week, temperatures are going to be feeling a bit cooler. Looking forward to next week, high pressure is going to be weakening a little bit. That's going to allow some cloud cover to scoot back in over our region, and the temperatures are going to remain generally close to its average for this time of year. But talking about what's happening right now on satellite and radar, not a whole lot to speak of. Generally clear skies. High pressure has been in place over Southern California, helping to steer all that moisture over the Pacific way up to the north. So the Pacific Northwest is getting all the action right now with the rain and the ice and the snow. And around here, we're staying pretty quiet for these next few days. For tonight, we'll drop down to 50 degrees. Mainly clear skies. A look around the area, expect to see temperatures in the 40s and low 50s in Southern California at the coast, more like 30s to 40s for those farther inland. And again, skies are mostly going to be clear. A look forward to Saturday shows high pressure in place over Southern California still, so that will allow us to stay rather dry, and we'll also get a little bit milder with the temperatures coming down just slightly in Southern California. High temp going to be around 72 in Oceanside, 70 degrees in San Diego. We'll make it up into the low 80s farther inland and higher up in elevation. I look forward to New Year's. Going to be dealing with an icy mix in the deep south, but around here, generally going to be staying quiet. No big weather problems in our neck of the woods. Again, we will have a little bit more cloud cover coming back in spots for Tuesday and Wednesday. At the coast, high temperatures are going to be in the upper 60s to low 70s for the weekend, and staying pretty similar to that as we head into the start of 2018. Inland temperatures Warm on Saturday at 80 degrees, mid and upper 70s, Sunday through Wednesday. The forecast for the mountain region going to be in the mid 60s for Saturday, getting cooler for Sunday and the new year. And finally, a look at the desert region will be in the mid and upper 70s. Back to you, Ebony.
There are hundreds of New Year's Eve parties happening this weekend. Here to explore some alternative options is KPBS Arts Calendar Editor Nina Guerin.
If you're still looking for something to do on New Year's, consider spending it with one of San Diego's best bands, Rocket from the Crypt. Punk band that celebrates 1950s style showmanship, complete with a horn section and fancy outfits. Rocket from the Crypt knows how to do big celebrations, whether the guys are dressed in skeleton costumes for Halloween or sparkly tuxedos for New Year's. It's a blend of old and new and a sure bet for ringing in 2018. If you're looking for something a bit more mellow, you can party like it's 1899 at the Salute to Vienna New Year's concert. Back for its 19th year, this is another San Diego favorite. You'll hear waltzes and operettas performed by a full orchestra and European singers. There are also costumed dancers performing romantic vignettes and the famous Blue Danube Waltz. Traditionally, this concert happens in January, but this year it's coming the night before New Year's Eve. For a more social way to spend the new year, consider strapping on some roller skates and having a roller skate party. Skate World San Diego has a family-friendly superhero-themed celebration. Dress up as your favorite character, or don't, and skate into 2018. Your ticket gets you skate rentals, food, and noisemakers. You'll find many, many more New Year's Eve options to explore on our website, kpbs.org/events. For KPBS Arts, I'm Nina Guerin.
With award season in full swing and the year coming to a close, KPBS cinema junkie Beth Accomando looks back on 2017 to pick the best of the year.
Although the following films didn't make my 10 best list, I was thrilled to see female superheroes on screen and behind the camera for Patty Jenkins' Wonder Woman, and to see women filmmakers also interested in more human-scaled problems, like Greta Gerwig with her directorial debut, Lady Bird. But I have to narrow the list down, so I'll start with a tie at the number 10 spot, because these two films proved to be oddly compelling companion pieces. Both address tabloid headline cases in ways that are fresh, hilarious, and horrific. The films are the mockumentary I, Tonya, about the Tonya Harding Olympic scandal, and the documentary Casting JonBenet that reimagines the documentary format. At number 9 is Dawson City Frozen Time, another film that rethinks what a documentary can be. Bill Morrison creates a genuine found footage film from nitrate film stock discovered in the frozen Yukon territory. At 8 is the French cannibal film Raw that proves to be more about the lengths people will go to show their love than about horror. And at number 7 is The Last Jedi. I know it has flaws, but I love it anyway. And I loved what it added to the Star Wars saga and mythology. In the number 6 slot is Yorgos Lanthimos's Killing of a Sacred Deer. It's not quite horror, not quite supernatural, but entirely creepy and disquieting. At 5 is the thoroughly original and unconventional romance, The Phantom Thread, re-teaming actor Daniel Day-Lewis with director Paul Thomas Anderson. The next 3 films could be in any order. They're all brilliant in some way, but each is so different from the other that it's hard to compare them. But here goes. At number 4 is Get Out. I love Jordan Peele's film for its originality and its clever use of horror tropes to make a visceral social commentary about race in America. At number 3 is Martin McDonagh's Three Billboards Outside Ebbing, Missouri. McDonagh wrote the film for actress Frances McDormand, and she tears up the screen as a woman bent on justice. And at number 2 is Dee Reese's Mudbound. The film hooked me with its vivid sense of time and place and its unflinching look at how horrific some people can be and what's needed to rise above that. And finally, my number one pick for 2018 is Guillermo del Toro's The Shape of Water. It's a dark adult fairy tale that finds beauty and love, but without being blind to the ugliness in the world. That's it for 2017. Here's looking forward to 2018. Beth Agamondo, KPBS News.
A special look back on what's been a wild year. The silence breakers, fake news, Trump's rise to power, immigration, wildfires, and the Chargers' departure. It's the top stories of 2017. Join us for the KPBS Roundtable tonight at 8:30.
Magic the Gathering is a fantasy card game, but it can also be a real career. The top players each year fight for a $100,000 top prize. Millions of people around the world play Magic, but the next champion may be a 7-year-old from San Diego. She recently squared off against KPBS producer Michael Lipkin.
Forest, I wish Mystic, go ahead.
I've been playing Magic the Gathering for longer than Dana Fisher has been alive.
Go to combat?
But she's already one of the game's more accomplished players.
Welcome back, everybody, to coverage of Grand Prix Las Vegas. This is Dana Fisher versus Philip Cox. This is Elves versus Burn matchup.
Magic is like this card game. It takes a lot of strategy, math, and luck. A wizard druid?
Mm-hmm.
Go to combat?
Sure.
There's all sorts of creatures in Magic the Gathering. Goblins, elves, pirates, dinosaurs, dragons.
In Magic, players each have a deck of cards, with different cards representing spells or some of those fantastical creatures. The creatures can attack or defend players, and there's a strategy in how to defeat your opponents.
I like playing Magic because I get to be like with people, meet new people, play against my dad and beat my dad, and be competitive in Magic tournaments.
Oh, yes, there you go. And Dana Fisher here up the first match. And oh, everybody is so excited.
Almost every week, there's a Magic Grand Prix being held somewhere in the world. Those are major tournaments, and players who do well in the early rounds get to stay for a second day. They compete for a top prize of $10,000.
I'm really competitive. Like, every Grand Prix I hear of, I go to my dad, I want to go. And then we have to talk to my mom, and sometimes my mom says no, and sometimes my dad says no because it's too far, but I like to go.
I think your dad's going to fix your hat a little bit.
I'm very proud of how 3 times and 2 times in a row, I was 1 win away from making day 2, 5 wins and 4 losses, and you have to go 6 wins, 3 losses. So I was very close, and I'm really proud of that.
Dana started playing Magic when she was just 3.5.
I learned the game from my dad. He was like, oh, I can't wait any longer. I don't want to wait till the 5 or 6, I want to teach them now. So then he started teaching us. It was very tough because I had to be able to read, but I couldn't. And he would read them to me, and I would have to memorize what they did. So that's kind of how I learned. And then once I was able to read, it went much faster. Well, I'm kind of like a fast person. I like fast decks. My favorite deck to play is Elves. Cavern of Souls, naming Elves. Go to combat. I like aggro, and Elves are just get stuff out there. Beat down. Yeah. Whoops. I think I want to do Magic for my job because it's just so fun. I think I'm going to be playing Magic forever and maybe work for Wizards of the Coast a little bit and be an artist, because also I want to be an artist when I grow up, so I could be an artist and do Magic. I could be a Magic artist.
Dana already has a sponsorship and wants to be the youngest player ever to make day 2 of a Grand Prix. It's a goal easily within reach.
So 19.
So that puts me at -9. You win. Good game.
Good game.
Michael Lipkin, KPBS News.
You can find tonight's stories on our website, kpbs.org/eveningedition. Finally, we leave you with the sounds of San Diego's own Zizzy Mizzy. Thanks for joining us. Have a great night.
Un, deux, un, deux, trois.